What's up, guys? Gerard Fabiano here for another video with ChannelFireball.com. If you are taking a look at the screen right now and thinking, what is going on? Well, that's exactly what I'm going for, because this deck, even though it looks pretty crazy, even though it looks like some cards you might not even know were legal in the modern format, it is a deck that I think is very well positioned and is a deck that could help you win a PPTQ, RPTQ, Grand Prix, Pro Tour, whatever the case may be. This is a deck that definitely attacks from different angles, and I'm going to go over it in details, and of course, we're going to do a competitive league. But before we start with that, I just want to talk about Grand Prix New Jersey, which happened a few days ago. In case you weren't aware, I ended up coming in third place. It was an amazing tournament. Just a quick rundown of the tournament. I started the tournament with two buys. I ended up winning the first round that I played, which was round three. So I'm 3-0, playing in the fourth round, and I'm playing against an opponent. We had a great match. It comes down to turn five of extra turns, and my opponent had a very big, overwhelming advantage. He had three creatures down to my none, and instead of taking the draw, I decided to concede to my opponent and give him the win. It was in the spirit of the game, because we actually had a one-minute time extension, which both of us forgot about, and the judge said that we couldn't rewind and add that extra minute. And if we did have that extra minute, my opponent would have definitely won the game. So I wanted to do the honorable thing, and I ended up conceding and giving my opponent the win. He was very thankful. So I found myself 3-1. In the next round, I played against TBS, Ben Seck, and he had a great deck. We had a nice match, but unfortunately, he also beat me. So now I'm 3-2. And in case you guys aren't aware, for you to make the top eight of a Grand Prix, you normally have to go 13-2, just because the size of the Grand Prix nowadays. And I ended up rattling off 10 wins in a row to make the top eight, and then I won my top eight match as well, making it 11 match wins in a row. So some might say it might have been good karma that I ended up, you know, conceding to my opponent in the spirit of the game. It was kind of a flashback of Baltimore 2015. I was also 3-2, and I ended up winning 13 matches in a row, actually conceding in the finals of game two when I got a favorable ruling. You guys could check that video out on YouTube. But what I'm saying here is that when you're playing Magic, no matter what your record is, if you're winning, if you're losing, try to do what you are proud of and what you believe in. And just try to be a positive person, because that's how you could go far in life and that's how you become successful. And I want you guys to become successful, especially in the modern format, especially with this deck right here. So let's jump right in. We have a red-black, I'm calling it Bridgewalkers, all right? So we have four Ensnaring Bridges, and we have a lot of Planeswalkers. Therefore, Bridgewalkers was the name that I came up with. This deck kind of is a deck that preys on the metagame, meaning we have four Relic of Progenitus in the main deck. If you think about Modern, there's lots of decks that are either heavily graveyard-based or have some interaction with the graveyard. So having four Relic, you already have a huge advantage against decks like Living End, Mono Blue Living End, decks like Storm, decks like Dredge, any decks that are playing Tarmogoyf, any decks that are playing Snapcaster Mage, any decks that are playing Knight of the Reliquary. So having four relics is something that I think is a smart move to have right now in the modern format. And at the end of the day, you could always cycle it for one mana, casting it, and of course, one mana to cycle. We have eight discard spells in the one drop, Inquisition and Thoughtseize. Very good against a lot of the decks out there. Our two drops are filled with Collective Brutality, some more discard, some gain life, and some removal. Knight's Whispers. Yeah, Knight's Whispers is one of my favorite cards. Just two mana, draw two. You're losing two life, but that's okay. We got a couple of Ratchet Bombs, Dreadbore, and then we get into the core of the deck. We have Liliana of the Veil, Blood Moon, Ensnaring Bridge. And all those cards can make it really difficult for your opponent to function. In Snaring Bridge, if they have big creatures, they're not attacking. If they have non-basic lands, they might not be able to cast their spells. And Liliana of the Veil really puts a strain on your opponent's resources. So they have to decide, am I going to keep a land? Am I going to keep a spell? Maybe I'll keep the spell and hope to draw land. So Liliana of the Veil fits nicely in this type of deck. Koth the Hammer and Chandra, Torch of Defiance. Some really good Planeswalkers, especially with Blood Moon. And of course, a couple of Obnixilis to finish off the curve. We have zero creatures in the main deck. So our opponent's Path to Exiles, Dismembers, Fatal Push are all going to be stuck in their hand and not going to do too much. Sure, maybe they could discard it to a Liliana of the Veil. But other than that, we're going to have an advantage against many decks game one. If we take a look at the sideboard, we have a couple of more removal spells in the form of Fatal Push. But we kind of sideboard into a more aggressive package against decks that we have to put pressure on. We have four copies of Pack Rat. We have a couple of Goblin Realm Masters and a few other utility creatures along with two Boils. Now, some might say this is kind of similar to a strategy of a Lantern type deck. However, I would say it's kind of different. You're attacking with different angles in the form of the Planeswalkers. Of course, you both share with the Snaring Bridge. But Lantern has trouble against certain decks like Tron, especially green-black Tron or green-white Tron, where A, you're not putting too much pressure on the opponent, and B, they might still be able to cast some of their spells. Well, with Blood Moon, that's going to be a bit more difficult for your opponent to do. And with Chandra and Koth, you're able to close out the game much quicker, especially when you're looking into the sideboard of Pack Rat and Goblin Rabbitmaster. Well, I'm super excited for this deck. I'm super excited to try to make a run at this competitive league that we're about to join. So make sure you guys stay tuned. This is Gerard Fabiano here with Red Black Bridgewalkers, and we're going to be playing. So stay tuned, and I'm really hoping we do well with this deck. All right, guys. What's up, guys? Gerard Fabiano here, and this is actually round two. Unfortunately, I didn't record round one. We did win. We played against Valakut. It was Primeval Titan, Scapeshift, Valakut deck, and we won pretty easily. So you guys didn't miss too much there, but we'll definitely be here for all four rounds going forward. Hopefully we could 4-0 on stream and we could finish up 5-0. So we won the die roll, so we're going to play. Again, this is the black-red Bridgewalker deck. In the deck tech, I talked about the strategy behind the deck and, you know, the different angles that this deck really attacks from. We're playing zero creatures in the main deck, so a lot of our opponent's removal will be useless and be stuck in their hand. And our main strategy is to drop in a Snaring Bridge after we did some discard spells, then follow up with a Planeswalker and take over the game from there. Our hand right here is definitely good. And I think that this deck is a deck that a lot of people will have no clue how to play against you, and B, very, very well positioned in the current metagame of Modern, because there's so many decks in Modern that try to just do one thing. And this deck has so many cards to stop that one thing your opponent might be trying to do. For example, Relic. Relic is a card that we have in our opening hand, and obviously we'll play Relic. I just want to see if we want to use Marsh Flats. Now, I think we just want to lead off with Swamp. But Relic is a card that, you know, we play four of that could really shut down your opponent's strategy if their strategy is to build up their graveyard. And Snaring Bridge could shut down your opponent's strategy if they're trying to attack with big creatures. Blood Moon, so on and so forth. So this deck is definitely something that I like. And we'll see how we do. So round one, we did defeat Valakut. And this is round two. Looks like we might be up against maybe like Blue-Eye Control or Jeskai Control. So we'll see how things go in this matchup. So we'll just play a Marsh Flats here. If we are against Jeskai, Blood Moon is pretty good against the Jeskai decks. Jeskai normally only has about three islands and one Plains. We'll let that Serum's Vision resolve, can't really do too much. We'll be sure to use Relic at the end of the turn to keep our opponent's graveyard in check. And Blood Moon's good in this matchup for sure. And also Relic's really good because our opponent's likely to have Snapcaster Mage. Our opponent's likely to have something like a Logic Knot. So just keeping their graveyard in check will definitely give us some small edges. And something like Blood Moon could really lock out our opponent from the game. So we're not going to pay the two life. We don't want to crack Relic, so we'll just untap and take a draw. All right, so got a handful of Planeswalkers. Normally, dropping it in a Snaring Bridge here would be something that we would want to do. But when facing against a deck like Jeskai, which we probably think they're Jeskai or Blue-White Control, Bridge isn't very good. So our sideboard is going to be definitely take out the Ensnaring Bridges, go more aggressive in the forms of like Pack Rat, Goblin Rabblemaster, and of course we're going to bring in Boil. So we're just going to pass a turn instead since we have both our Koths in hand, and Koth could, you know, really do a lot of damage by ticking up and making one of our mountains a 4-4. And then of course trying to ultimate Koth is the goal, because once you get the emblem, the opponent really can't do too much. It's not something that they could, you know, Detention Sphere away or you know, Path to Exile it away. It's the emblem's there and it's going to stick there. All right, so another Serum's Vision from the opponent. I always say Serum's Vision. It's Serum Visions. So that's probably like my number one complaint. You guys have been awesome. You guys have been given such positive comments. You know, you guys have been liking the videos, watching my videos. So I do really appreciate it. And I will try to work on the pronunciations of many of these cards, because that's something that I'm not too strong at. So this might be a Spreading Seas. Our opponent's tapping a blue and white. And if it is, oh, it's okay. Search for Iskanta. Very good card. But that's also good for us for a couple of reasons. Number one, Relic matches up pretty well against Search. And two, our opponent is tapped out, meaning either Chandra or Koth can resolve here. Okay, and there's a Thoughtseize too, so Thoughtseize is going to be pretty nice. So, normally, okay, this is interesting. So, if we go Chandra tick up, our opponent goes to 18. Koth has, I want to say, a better ultimate or a better you know, emblem, because we could get there quicker. And we have two copies of Koth in case our opponent has something like a Detention Sphere. They would be likely to use it. So I'm actually going to play Koth here. So we'll play Koth. We'll tick up Koth. We'll bash in for four and pass the turn. So pretty close. There could be some argument to play Chandra here. And if there's ever an interesting play or an interesting line, and I take one line, you know, feel more than free to comment and try to put like the timestamp at this point, because I do read almost all the comments and I have been trying to respond to everybody who leaves a comment. So definitely if there's an interesting line of play, it's Magic is a game where the more you discuss it, the more you kind of analyze it, and the more you're honest with your plays, the more you're going to learn. That's just kind of how it is. If you're always saying, oh, I got unlucky this, I got unlucky that, you're probably wasting too much energy complaining and not enough energy trying to get better or understand where maybe things went wrong. All right, so our opponent with a Field of Ruin. Not too sure what our opponent's plan is. Of course, we don't know anything in their hand currently, but we'll probably be able to take a good look next turn with Thoughtseize, especially if we end up finding a land. If it comes down to it, in certain spots, you could always tick down Koth to get some extra mana. So that's something that you could always do. All right, so we'll Relic away our opponent's Visions. And Wall of Omens, you know, not going to do too much here. Basically, just cycles for the opponent. we'll take a draw here. Okay. Nixless is a pretty good draw. So this is a situation where maybe ticking down Koth could be good. One line of play can be Thoughtseize, take the opponent's counter if they have something like a remand, or they might just use the remand, or and then follow it up with the Obnixilis to start getting some card advantage. And I think that's what I'm going to do, because Koth will produce two red. So let's go with a Thoughtseize. I think this is probably the best line. All right. So there's a Path, a Snapcaster, a Spell Snare, and a Verdict. So Path is not going to do anything. Snapcaster Mage, Spell Snare is not going to do anything, and Supreme Verdict is not going to do anything. So we're in excellent shape. I think that, you know, if there was the advantage bar, even though the life totals are 1916 and it's still pretty early, I would say the advantage bar is heavily favored towards us. So we're going to take the Snapcaster Mage. Then we're actually going to tick down the Koth. We'll filter and we'll get two black and we'll play the Obnixilis. And at this point, I can't really see. I mean, yeah, I can't really see our opponent doing too much. I mean, our opponent's likely line is them to Path the Wall of Omens, then our opponent getting in with Celestial Colonnade, I guess, taking out the Koth, which isn't going to really do too much because our follow-up play could be, you know, Chandra and Snaring Bridge. So let's draw a card with the Obnixilis. Finding a land here could be pretty good. Oh, wow, a Liliana, just as good. And then we'll pass the turn. So it's all right. So our opponent didn't even take that line where our opponent declined going for the Path to Exile and the Wall of Omens. I guess that is one of the advantages, like I just said previously, of our opponent not knowing what we're playing. So maybe our opponent thinks the Path has value in their hand. But we know that the Path is pretty much dead and the Supreme Verdict is pretty much useless as well. So our opponent puts an island in the graveyard and a turn will relic. And it's likely our opponent is just going to pass the turn here. Yep. So at this point in the game, and if you are playing against another control deck, you will normally have the advantage because your Planeswalkers, when playing against another slow deck, just gets you so much advantage that the longer the game goes, the more times you get to use your Planeswalker, the more advantage you're really gaining. All right, so let's go with an Inquisition here. We don't want to lead off with the Collective Brutality because we know the opponent has Spell Snare. At this point, yeah, I mean, it just doesn't really matter at all, I would say. Let's just take the Path. Here, Liliana tick up. Might be just safer to get the Ensnaring Bridge. Let's think. So, maybe just getting down Chandra is fine. Let's just do that. All right, Chandra. And then just tick up Chandra so it's out of range of the Colonnade. And I can't really see our opponent getting out of this. So exile the top card. Thoughtseize, obviously not casting it. We might as well just relic now, and then we'll pass the turn. So you can see the power of this deck when playing against another slow deck. But, I mean, even if we're playing against a deck that was more mid-rangey and their plan was try to attack with creatures, of course, we would still have Ensnaring Bridge in hand. So Ensnaring Bridge works extremely well game one with the Planeswalker strategy. And then after board, if Ensnaring Bridge doesn't seem that great, you want to board into the Pack Rats, go a bit more aggressive. So Colonnade is coming in, maybe taking out the Koth. That probably seems like the best line for our opponent. All right, so Koth hits the bin. Oh, wow, Blood Moon. Perfect draw there. So let's draw another card with Obnixilis. Nice, we hit a Swamp. Let's just get some mana with Chandra. Let's drop Blood Moon. Let's get down Koth. Let's untap the mountain. Let's bash in. And this game is pretty much over. Yep, our opponent concedes. So just like that, we are up a game. Again, this is round two. Round one, we did defeat Valakut. It was, you know, Primeval Titan, Scape Shift, Secure Tribe Elder. And this round, we are playing against Blue-White Control. So let's go to sideboard so we can kind of understand what everything, you know, what plan do we have and how we're going to sideboard. So Ratchet Bombs are normally really good just against the smaller type decks, but they're also pretty versatile because your opponent can always have a card like Leyline of Sanctity, which is pretty difficult for this card, for this deck to overcome, but Ratchet Bomb does give us an answer. The first cards we're going to start with taking out are definitely in the Ensnaring Bridges. Just not what we want against this deck. We want to be more aggressive. So the Ensnaring Bridges are coming out for the Pack Rats. It's likely that our opponent sideboards out most of their removal spells. I think that the mages are pretty good here as well, so we're going to bring those in. Rabble Master we want. We definitely want Boil. Olivia is a card that is just very, very powerful, so at any time you could always board it in. I think that we have so many cards that we already want that might be tight to fit Olivia in. We want to keep Relics in. And this matchup, something like Collective Brutality is pretty good because you're almost always able to take an instant or sorcery. However, since we have so much discard already and the other modes on Collective Brutality aren't really going to do too much, combined with the fact that our opponent might have Leyline, that we're going to take out the Collective Brutalities. That's going to be the first card to go. Ratchet Bomb. I want to leave in Ratchet Bomb. We already saw Search for Iskanta, so that's one right there. And there could definitely be other cards that we want to hit, such as Leyline, which I mentioned earlier. The one Dreadbore I want to leave in as well, because Dreadbore is pretty versatile, and it's just something where, you know, you never know what your opponent's going to sideboard in. One card that I do want to cut, especially since we are on the draw, are the Koth of the Hammer. We want to cut both of them. A little bit slow. Our opponent might still even Path to Exile. So, you know, them pathing a land, then us searching a land. Do we get ahead? Yeah, we kind of get ahead, but I think that Koth is okay to go. And the last card that we are going to cut, let's go with minus one Relic. Even though Relic's good here, I don't think we need four. I think we can get away with three, especially with all the other sideboard hate cards. Other card that we maybe could have cut is one Blood Moon since we're bringing in the mages, but regardless, you know, we're masters, right? Because we cut a Relic but still managed to get one. So that's pretty good because you only really need one Relic. But again, sideboarding with this deck, still a little bit new. I worked on this deck a good amount. I did play some leagues with this deck, and I definitely learned a lot. And this configuration is where I'm pretty happy with. So our opponent leads off with the Serum Visions. And we're just going to... I just want to go for the thoughtsies right here. Even though we have Ratchet Bomb for search, if they do have search, we want to take it. Oh, wow. So our opponent just really doesn't have anything going for them. We're going to take their mana leak. And they're just left with, you know, a few lands, a Path to Exile, and a Supreme Verdict. So I'm definitely liking our spot. Path to Exile as a card, not really a fan of. I know a lot of people do like Path to Exile. But I think that if you're playing a deck like Blue-White Control, Path really doesn't work well with your strategy, but it also doesn't really work well with many of the cards. So Thoughtseize is actually an excellent draw as well. So let's play Pack Rat, see if that resolves. Likely it will. You know, this is a spot where you're just really hoping your opponent paths your Pack Rat just because you're able to out-mana your opponent because you're just getting a free land. It's like your opponent's just giving, like literally saying, hey, you just get a free land because I would many times rather have a land than the Pack Rat. And one of these situations is not much different. Since we know our opponent has Supreme Verdict, the land is just going to have much more value. So we definitely want to search. We'll search up a Swamp. And on our turn four, we're able to go Thoughtseize Liliana. And Liliana is a very good card against any, or, you know, I shouldn't say any, but most control decks. All right, so we'll play around Mana Leak here with the Thoughtseize. And we'll take the Supreme Verdict, because that's the only thing we could take. Liliana. And now we're able to take up Liliana and discard a Mountain, because the Path to Exile gave us a free Swamp. We'll go get a Mountain here. Why not? And that worked out nicely for us because we're able to also play Relic. So let's tick up. Discard the Mountain. Another reason why I like this deck a lot is because the curve is actually pretty low. And I like the fact that we get to play just 21 lands. We do have the Relics and the Night's Whispers, as I mentioned earlier, to help us find lands. But the deck, I think, is pretty well built. You know, I don't want to say that it's the best way to build it, but with the idea I had, I think the interactions of Liliana and the Snaring Bridge and all the discard and the Planeswalkers, I think the whole strategy works well together. All right, so our opponent is just cycling. I guess hoping to find something. And there's a good chance this Liliana could just run away with the game. Wow, Boil. That's what I'm talking about, guys. The Boil. All right, so we want to tick up Liliana. Let's discard a Ratchet Bomb. And I think on our opponent's upkeep, we want to play Boil. So letting our opponent untap with 4 mana is okay because they still cannot cast Cryptic Command. But let's Boil. This should resolve. And if it does, yeah, wow. Okay, so I can't really see our opponent coming out of this one. At this point, you know, a Rabble Master will end the game pretty quick. A Pack Rat would be pretty nice. Yeah, so our opponent just concedes. I don't blame him. So takeaway from this match. Again, this was round two. Round one was not recorded, unfortunately, but we did defeat Valakut, Scapeshift, Primeval Titan deck. This round, we were up against Blue-White Control. Takeaway from this, I think our matchup against any control deck is excellent. We have the tools to beat control, and I think we also have the tools to beat aggressive decks as well. So I think this deck has some potential. We are 2-0. with the Black Red Bridgewalker deck. If you guys like this deck so far, make sure you guys stay tuned. We have three more rounds to go. This is Gerard Fabiano here for Channel Fireball, and we'll be back for round three. What's up, guys? Gerard Fabiano back for round three. And we won the die roll again, so that's pretty good. Take a look at our hand. Our hand is not as good, so we're going to mulligan our hand and hope for a better six. Pretty interesting. So, double Chandra, Relic, Inquisition, Collected Brutality. And with this hand, we're actually going to keep and we'll scry. So, Swamp on top, so we'll definitely keep that. I mean, it's not the best hand, but if we do find our lands, we'll be in pretty good shape. This is a spot where Night's Whisper really shines to help make up for a mulligan. So we're just going to play the Bloodstained Mire and pass just because Swamp is on top of our deck. And our opponent leads off with an Aether Vial. So could mean a couple of different things. Most likely, maybe like black-white Eldrazi. We'll find out pretty soon with Inquisition. So against these types of decks, sometimes they do have cards like Leonin Arbiter, where you can't search your deck unless you pay two. So I think this might be a spot to fetch up a Blood Crypt. I think we do want a Blood Crypt. We'll pay the two life. Let's Inquisition. Find out what we're working with. See what the opponent has. All right, so Thalia was something that I did expect. And Thalia is going to be kind of annoying. We do have Collective Brutality, but we might want to use that for the Flicker Wisp. Path to Exile, not going to do anything. Eldrazi Displacer and a couple of lands. So pretty interesting. I'm actually going to take the Thalia here. And then let's get down the Relic. And let's just remove the Thalia and pass the turn. So best possible draw here is probably going to be a Night's Whisper into a couple of lands. And Chandra could run away with the game, especially with Collective Brutality in hand, to kind of control some of the creatures. So, of course, our opponent ticks up the Aether Vial. And we do find a Swamp, which is pretty good. I think that just blowing the Relic here has some value, so let's do that. We might hit into another discard spell or a Night's Whisper. Okay, just a Koth. And we know that our opponent still has the Path to Exile that we could take, but Path's not really going to do too much. We're basically in a spot here where we definitely want to hit a Mountain. Probably our best line. Likely that our opponent is going to play a land and Eldrazi Displacer. So being able to untap, go Chandra, kill the Displacer would be excellent and put us in a spot where, you know, we're favored to win. I don't think Collective Brutality is going to be too insane in this matchup. -2/-2, you know, we do have some nice targets. Flicker Wisp is pretty good to take out. Dahlia is nice to take out. Uh-oh. Is this Eldrazi Displacer, or is this... Okay, just a Displacer. We need a land here. Not a land. Dreadbore is not a terrible draw. So we'll try taking out the Displacer. It's likely that next turn, our opponent is going to Flicker Wisp the Blood Creep... the Blood Crypt, excuse me. And on the upkeep. So, I actually The reason why I said blood creep was because I was thinking upkeep and then blood crypt. Makes perfect sense. Okay, so our opponent doesn't do that. Interesting. Let's go with a ratchet bomb here. Ratchet bomb could be okay. Again, we're still short one mana, but you know, I'm gonna hold pretty firm to the 21 lands. I think 21 lands is where you want to be at with this deck. So our opponent has a path still in hand. I don't really think taking out the Aether Vial has too much value. Probably a little bit of value. We'll see if that's what we want to do. Well, we're definitely going to put a counter on the bomb, so let's just do it now. Probably better to do it at the end step, but... All right, so maybe our opponent's a little bit flooded here. We do not want to pay the 2 life. Wow. Sick draw. All right, so... We're definitely blowing the Ratchet Bomb, considering we just drew Blood Moon. That was a sick draw. This could lock our opponent out of the game. Okay, so another Flicker Wisp. So, what we need to do is, I mean, we just need to drop Blood Moon here. I mean, there might be a small chance our opponent, you know, floats a white mana and then paths their Flicker Wisp. But if that happens, I'm also definitely pretty happy with that as well. So our opponent has a path and an unknown in hand. Okay, so our opponent does do that line of play that we suspected he or she might had done, fetching up a basic Plains. But this definitely puts us in a nice spot. You know, we'll be able to collect the Brutality away, the Flicker Wisp, and then as soon as we draw one more land, we'll be able to play either Koth or Chandra or both. Okay, so there's an Obnixilis. Trying to think here. Is there any card that we might want to take from our opponent? I'm going to say no. Now let's try to think if we want to gain that 2 life. Maybe by discarding a Chandra. Yeah, I think that's fine. So escalate 2 modes. Lose 2 life. Minus 2. I think this is just playing it a bit safe, but I think that's fine. I think given our hand of Chandra, Koth, and Obnixilis, and we're just one land away, we should be in a pretty good spot. Okay, so another path to exile. Interesting. All right, now our opponent gets a basic swamp. So I'm still okay with this because our opponent can't cast any of their Eldrazi creatures. I mean, they could cast Eldrazi Displacer, but all right, Wasteland Strangler, not going to do too much. And they could cast Wasteland Strangler. When I mean Eldrazi creatures, obviously Thought Not Seer, Reality Smasher. All right, so definitely a good draw there. Let's get down. So we could get down Koth. Bashing for 4. Koth gets a deck down to 1. We play Chandra, kill the Wasteland Strangler. Or we just play Chandra, kill the Wasteland Strangler. Tick up. Yeah, I think Chandra's a better line here because we have Obnixilis in hand. All right, so the pressure is pretty much on the opponent right now. We're in a nice spot with Blood Moon and Chandra. All right, so let's play out the land. Let's tick up Chandra. All right, just a swamp. So we'll cast Obnixilis. And it's likely our opponent's probably going to concede in this turn or their next turn. Yeah, so... All right, so up a game. Again, when playing against this Eldrazi deck, we have a lot of cards that the opponent is basically really scared of. I think the opponent's most likely going to be scared of a card like Ensnaring Bridge. The opponent will be most likely scared of a card like Blood Moon. But let's take a look at the sideboard and see what plan we want to go with. Definitely want Fatal Push here. Our opponent has some early creatures. Thalia is nice to get rid of. Also, considering the fact that we do have 8 fetch lands, we could turn on Fatal Push's Revolt ability. Do we want the Mages? I think Mage definitely has some merit here. I think Olivia's pretty good. I don't think that we want Pack Rat. I think our opponent's creatures are probably just too good, and Pack Rat doesn't really match up too well against a card like Eldrazi Displacer. So Pack Rat's going to stay in the sideboard. Collective Brutality, I can see trimming down on. Our opponent didn't see Ensnaring Bridge yet, so they might not be aware of our plan. All right, so I think just getting rid of the Collective Brutalities. Relics aren't going to do too much. I think bringing in the Mages, maybe 2 Mage, 2 Brutality could be nice. So Obnixilus, yeah, Chandra. Koth in the draw, again, I'm not in love with. Maybe Koth needs to go for another Mage. Maybe Brutality is better than I'm giving credit for. Blood Moon, Liliana's good, Night's Whisper's good. All right, let's run them like this and see how things play out. So again, this is Gerard Fabiano. This is round 3. We are 2-0 with Black-Red Bridgewalker deck. Again, if you guys have any comments or if you guys like this video, make sure you do that. But I'm more focused with your thoughts and any plays that I might have done or I might do that you know, you want to chat about, definitely down for that. Or any card suggestions as well. Hey, what about this card? Maybe this could be good in this matchup. Did you try this card out? I do like discussing Magic. And when I do have a new deck, especially Modern, you know, I've become a bigger and bigger fan of Modern. So, all right, this is interesting. Leyline of Sanctity. We talked about Leyline of Sanctity, and that's one of the reasons why we do have Ratchet Bomb in the deck. There could be an argument to have more than just 2 Ratchet Bombs. Maybe we should have, you know, 3 Ratchet Bombs in the main deck. Maybe we should even have a 4th in the sideboard. Originally, when I built this deck, it was black, red, splash, white, and the white was just for sideboard cards. The white was for, well, we had main deck Engineer's Explosive, so you wanted a 3rd color for that. And then in the sideboard, we had a Wear Tear and Oblivion Ring. All right, so let's crack this Marsh Flats. We'll get a Blood Crypt. Don't want to pay the 2 life. Ooh, Blood Moon, perfect draw there. So now we'll go get a Swamp. And let's Night's Whisper. All right, pretty good. We'll discard an Inquisition. You know, when you are on the draw, and if you don't play anything, Night's Whisper will force you to discard a card, which is okay. Because most likely you'll have, you know, either a Thoughtseize or an Inquisition or a Relic on turn 1. All right, so Leonian Arbiter, our opponent plays. And this, ooh, wow, Ghost Quarter. Ghost Quarter. All right. Just when we thought we had him. All right, so Blood Crypt, no need to pay the 2. And let's now Fatal Push the Arbiter. So again, just basically 1... Uh-oh, there's Thought-Nazi here. Oh, just so close for 2 turns with the Blood Moon, because Blood Moon is wicked good against the opponent's deck here. So they're definitely taking Blood Moon. And we do have Olivia, which could be pretty good for us. We'll see how things play out. Ooh, all right, so I was hoping to get a land there. Question is, do we want to block and then sack, take out the temple, or just, you know, kill the temple? And I think just killing the temple here is is safer, even though we're guaranteed to take 4 damage from the Thought Knot Seer. I think it's just too risky given our opponent that extra mana. So we are just one land away from being able to play Chandra or Olivia. You know, a Mountain here would be excellent, being able to take out the Thought Knot Seer. Wow, Blade Spicer. Okay, so I thought that we were definitely going to be able to pull out a victory this game, but it's looking very bad. And it might just be unwinnable at this point. So we'll go down to 4. Chandra's not going to be really able to save us at this point. Olivia's not going to do too much. So pretty sure we're just dead here. Maybe we get a bit more information from our opponent. All right, so there's a Flicker Wisp. Yeah, so that's pretty much it. All right, so game 3. I thought we were going to take that game down, but unfortunately we didn't. I think I do like most of the sideboard plan. A part of me now thinks maybe we should go lower on the discard spells. Maybe the Collective Brutalities are just too bad. Maybe the Pack Rat plan might actually be good. So bring in the 4 Pack Rats. And let's maybe even take out an Inquisition. Yeah, I think Blood Moon's just too powerful, so I don't think we want to trim on Blood Moon. Ensnaring Bridge could just close out a game as well. So even though it's kind of weird to have Pack Rat and Ensnaring Bridge, it's like part combo, part nombo, where like it's a combo because you're able to keep discarding, so your bridge is always, you know, online. But it's also a nombo because then you won't be able to attack with your Pack Rats. But ideally, you'll be able to just Ratchet Bomb away your bridge at a certain point. Liliana, good. Want to cut a Night's Whisper? No, I think this is pretty good. Good. Koth on the play now. All right, let's run it like this. All right, so we're going to play. And our hand is good. If our opponent plays a Ley Line, the hand gets much worse. All right, so perfect. Our opponent doesn't have a ley line. We're going to get the Blood Crypt. We'll pay some life. All right, so we'll Inquisition, see what our opponent has in hand. Aether Vial, Path to Exile, Thalia, and Tide Hollow Sculler. Let's take the Thalia here. Okay, it looks as though we are in pretty good shape. However, we definitely need to just hit at least one more land. All right, so there's the Vial from the opponent, Aether Vial. All right, so another Inquisition. Most likely taking the Tide Hollow Sculler. Yep, exactly. Our opponent picked up a Flicker Wisp, which is okay for us, since we'll be able to Inquisition that away next turn as well. I guess when we're cutting the relics, it does get a little bit more dangerous because we're taking out, you know, 4 cyclers, so we definitely can't cut Night's Whisper. So that's why we have the 4 Night's Whispers in it. Or that's something to consider, you know? All right, let's go with an Inquisition again. All right, we'll take the Flicker Wisp this time. And our opponent does have a Thought Knot Seer in hand, so let's hope they don't draw Eldrazi Temple. All right, so there's your Shambling Vents. All right, so Ensnaring Bridge could be useful once we find our third land. Let's Thought Seize our opponent. We'll take their Thought Knot Seer, and their last card will be a Path to Exile in hand. All right, so like in our spot here, just have to find one more land. or, you know, Night's Whisper should get us to some lands as well. So definitely have a lot of outs this turn. We did keep a two-lander, and then we, I think we, you know, ran off like three or four spells in a row. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Three lands in a row. Three spells in a row, excuse me. All right, boom. That's what we're looking for. So Bloodstained Mire. And I think this is a good chance, or a good spot, I should say, to play Liliana. So the Liliana and Snaring Bridge combo is going to be excellent. We'll tick this up. I think getting rid of Fatal Push is definitely fine here. And our opponent gets rid of their Path to Exile, which means Olivia is, you know, free to come down next turn. So this might just be an activation of Shambling Vent and attacking Liliana for two. Yep, that's exactly what it is. Okay, so kind of interesting. Maybe just land Olivia. Don't use Liliana. What could be the card that our opponent drew? Could be a Path to Exile. Definitely something to consider. Maybe it's just land in Snaring Bridge. Then next turn, Olivia tick up. That might be better. It's probably a better line. So let's just go with the Snaring Bridge. Let's not use the Liliana this turn. Liliana is actually a really sometimes difficult card to play. Sometimes people are just like, okay, Liliana, tick up, Liliana, tick up. And I think that that's something that I used to do. It's definitely okay not to use Liliana. It's like one of the few Planeswalkers where you don't want to use their plus ability all the time. Most of the time you're like, oh yeah, you know, Jace, draw a card, or Jace, brainstorm, whatever the case may be. Well, I guess that's a zero ability, but you guys get the idea. Normally when you have a Planeswalker, you want to use the plus ability. Chandra plus, we'll use that for an example. All right, so there's an Arbiter from our opponent. And they're going to Coast Quarter us, so nothing we could do there. Huh. Well, we have the Liliana, so we just got to put it to good use. And plus, I would rather have Chandra online than Olivia anyway. So let's just tick up Liliana. Our opponent discards a Flickerwisp. And I think our opponent's in a pretty tough spot here. There's another Ensnaring Bridge. Well, we'll get down another Ensnaring Bridge. I'm fine with our opponent being able to Ghost Quarter us here. I think I'm so fine with it that at this point, let's just get rid of the Chandra. Let's just tick up Liliana. Let's try to get to the ultimate. Our opponent's in such a bad spot, I want to say, that I think ultimating the Liliana or getting to the ability to ultimate Liliana is more important than worrying about our opponent. You know, it's cool, you know? Like, our opponent has a Leon Arbiter down. They get their combo with the Ghost Quarter. That's pretty cool, but Modern does get to a point where, you know, you could do your cool little thing, but if someone else is doing something way more devastating to you, it doesn't matter. You know, it's just like, you could just kill all my lands, but I have Liliana and a Steering Bridge in play, so it's unlikely you'll be able to come out of this. All right, there's a Night's Whisper. Yeah, why not? Let's go for it. Going out to 10 seems like okay. And let's take up Liliana. We'll get rid of the Pack Rat here. I think I would rather have Nice Whisper. You know, maybe hit a few more land drops. We're still at 10. All All right, let's nice whisper. We'll go down to 8. And play the Blood Crypt. Let's take a Liliana one more time. I'm fine with discarding and getting rid of Ratchet Bomb. I can't really see our opponent drawing running answers to these bridges. And this turn, we're definitely going to use Liliana. So let's Liliana our opponent before doing anything. It's always fun when you get the Liliana minus 6. You know, that's something I always like doing. All right, so rearrange the piles. How does this work on Magic Online? Is it like a double click? Okay, it is a double click. So let's start separating the lands. Two caves. Four lands. Yeah, this seems pretty good. Do we want the shambling events switched? No. Okay, let's go with this. So this definitely puts our opponent in a difficult spot. All right. We could dread bore away the Arbiter. And we'll pass the turn. So at this point, we're just waiting for something to close out the game. All right, nice. Obnixilus is a pretty good draw there. I don't think we need the third Ensnaring Bridge, so I would rather start trying to take up Liliana. So our opponent discards a path. Opponent's Vial is on 4. Maybe this is Eldrazi Displacer. It is, okay. So Displacer comes down. Ooh, there's a Blood Moon. Blood Moon's a nice one. Yeah, let's just play Blood Moon. I don't want to use Liliana quite yet because I want to have Obnixilus in play. Because that could be one of our win conditions. You know, just use Obnixilus ability 3 times, then we're able to minus 8 it. Again, I think just passing the turn seems fine. Our opponent's in a pretty tough spot. I mean, this is like how you imagine you're playing for top 8 and you're playing for top 8 of the Pro Tour, and this is like the last game 3 before top 8, and this is your board state. So, all right, our opponent does Pithy Needle the Liliana of the Veil. So, kind of interesting. We could Night's Whisper, but that could be a little risky. Pithy Needle was a good draw from our opponent. Makes me think maybe we should have just Liliana'd away the Displacer. What we could do is just Fatal Push the Eldrazi Displacer so the opponent cannot attack. That might be the best play here. All right, so let's pass the turn. I guess we could lose this game. Maybe we're just a little bit too confident. But we are just basically one land away from being able to play Obnixilus. Maybe the Ratchet Bomb was important to keep. Maybe going to 8 was a bit risky. So we're going to Fatal Push the Eldrazi Displacer. It's not going to kill the Eldrazi Displacer, but the reason why we Fatal Push, so then our opponent cannot attack with it. So it's kind of like 1 mana, you know, gain 3 life. every other card in our deck we'll be able to cast. And I, you know, if we have to, we could always Night's Whisper this turn. Remember, Eldrazi Displacer is exile another target creature, so it can't exile itself. So we're in our upkeep right now. Oh no, another Fatal Push. Okay, another Fatal Push. Again, I don't think we want a Night's Whisper. I think we just want to play it extremely cautious. So, I mean, our opponent is almost locked out of this game, you know? So let's Fatal Push again, which is another, you know, one mana, gain three life. All right, so there's a mage, so that's pretty good. We'll get that down. And we'll pass the turn. So, if there was the advantage bar, I do like that advantage bar that they use on the coverage. I would still say our advantage bar is heavily in our favor. All right, so there's a swamp. That's exactly what we're looking for. Let's get down the Obnixilis. Let's just tick up. So we're down to 7, but our goal at this point is just to try to get to 8 as quick as possible. Oh no. There's a Pithing Needle on the Obnixilis. Okay. So, again, pretty interesting. I feel like this is probably the most drawn-out game where we had a huge advantage. I think we still have a pretty big advantage. All right. That's what I'm talking about, guys. There's the Ratchet Bomb. Boom. Just like that. Ratchet Bomb's good. Maybe we should have 3 Ratchet Bombs in the main deck. If you guys can think of what you want to cut. I mean, maybe we don't need 4 relics. Maybe we could get away with 3. But then if we go down to 3 relics, we might want to draw. Or I'm sorry, we might want to add another land. Because we might not draw that many lands. So let's put a counter on the Ratchet Bomb. Okay, boom. Our opponent concedes the match. And just like that, we are 3-0 with the Black-Red Bridgewalker deck. Round 1. We didn't record, but we did defeat Valakut. Round 2, we were up against Blue-White Control, and, you know, that was a pretty easy matchup. And then this round, we were against Black-White Eldrazi, and it did go to 3 games, but I feel that this is also a good matchup. So we're 3-0. We'll be back for round 4 and round 5 in a minute. So make sure you guys stay tuned. This is Gerard Fabiano for Channel Fireball. Thank you for watching. All right, guys, this is Gerard Fabiano. It is pretty late. It's 11:34, but of course, we're going to power through. We are 3-0 with this black-red walker, Bridgewalker deck, and we have another nice hand. You know, 3 lands, Thoughtseize, Night's Whisper, and of course, Blood Moon. I don't think Blood Moon's going to be too good in this matchup, and there's a good chance Ensnaring Bridge might not be too good. It looks like we might be up against Storm just by the look of the island and the turn 1 Serum's Visions. We'll find out in a moment. And let's just go with Swamp Thoughtseize. Let's see what our opponent has. I'm guessing it's Storm. And wow. All right, so we're 3-0, and there's a chance our opponent is also 3-0. It looks like we're against the blue-black Time Warp Take Turns deck. I'm a big fan of the Take Turns deck. I actually worked with Reed Duke on building one of the first versions, I want to say, or maybe not one of the first versions, but pretty early in the development process, blue-white. But regardless, we have to take this Howling Mine. That's how the deck really functions. They function on Howling Mine, Dictate a Kruphix, so they're able to get extra cards. And then they'll be able to take many turns with Time Warp and whatnot. So we want to stop their draw card engine. All right, so our opponent with the Watery Grave, and We find a blood crypt. So let's go with Bloodstained Mire. Let's just get another swamp here. And let's go for a Night's Whisper. So Blood Moon is actually going to be okay in this matchup. It's not going to be amazing, I don't think. But it's definitely going to be better here than if we were just against a blue-red storm deck. So sideboard, you know, and this is sometimes I do this. Sometimes you're in game one. I remember actually playing against Seth Manfield in the top four last week in a Grand Prix New Jersey. And I basically knew that game one was not going my way. Of course, you know, I'm not one just to concede. You don't want to do that. But as Seth was thinking, you know, you are allowed to look at your sideboard. So you could start thinking about your sideboard options. Like, hey, what am I going to do here? All right, so our opponent goes for the exhaustion. I think I'm okay with that. And let's go with a Blood Crypt here because we want to be able to cast Chandra next turn. And let's see if we could take anything with Inquisition. And we're able to take a Fatal Push. Fatal Push doesn't really do too much against us. Basically does almost nothing. I mean, we do have Koth in the deck. So I'm liking our spot. Our opponent really doesn't have too much going on. They do have Time Warp in hand. But they are down to two cards. And I don't really think our opponent's going to have too many answers to Chandra. All right, so there's a Snapcaster Mage. Most likely our opponent will target the Serum Visions. But it's cool to see the Time Warp deck in action. So this is like a double treat. You're seeing a deck that I'm playing for everybody out there, the Black-Red Bridgewalker deck, which is, you know, pretty unique. And we're playing against another pretty unique deck in the form of the Time Warp deck. Ooh, okay, Liliana. Liliana's pretty good too here. So, do we want to get down Chandra or Liliana? I actually think we want to go with Liliana. And we want to tick up Liliana. Let's get rid of Marsh Flats. So next turn, ideally we could go Chandra, get mana with Chandra, Blood Moon, and then also tick up Liliana. So our opponent actually discards the Time Warp. Maybe our opponent does have a Dictate in hand. Maybe they ended up drawing it. We'll find out shortly. Ooh, Inquisition. Okay. So let's take up Liliana. Let's start with that. Okay, so Dictate. So at this point, I guess still discarding a Snaring Bridge is probably better. Let's get another Swamp. All right, Chandra. Let's get mana with Chandra. Yeah, let's get mana with Chandra. And then let's drop a Blood Moon. So Snapcaster could bring Liliana down to one, which is okay. I'm liking our spot. You know, even though our opponent does have a Dictate out, which is one of their most important cards, they are a little short on mana. And we are still at a pretty high life total. And, you know, with Dictated Cruthix, both players get to draw two. Oh, wow. So our Snapcaster just comes right at us. Pretty interesting. So we draw Thoughtseize. So let's go with Inquisition. Let's lead off with that. Wow. Okay. So this is totally fine, though. Ooh, okay. So let's see. Our opponent has a Cryptic. All right, let's look at our top card with Chandra. Ensnaring Bridge We do not want to play Ensnaring Bridge. Let's take up Liliana. We know our opponent has Cryptic Command. All right, let's just discard Swamp. Kind of weird. I'm gonna discard Swamp and then hold Thoughtseize. So this is the line I'm going to go with. We'll see if our opponent uses Cryptic at the end of their turn. Or at the end of our turn, excuse me. Probably targeting the Chandra. Yeah, all right. So they bounce a Chandra. They draw a card. Totally fine with that. You know, we do have to be slightly careful of our life total. I'm actually probably more concerned with our life total than our opponent, you know, chaining time warps at this point. Oh, wow. Our opponent goes after Liliana now. All right. So last turn, our opponent attacked us down to 10. This turn, our opponent decides to go after Liliana. So it looks like our opponent... Okay, Giga Drowse on the upkeep. So we're fine with that. Most likely going to target all the swamps that we have. All right, so we find a Bloodstained Mire, but that's only a mountain. And another Bloodstained Mountain Mire. All right, so let's tick up Liliana. Discard a Mire. So our opponent discards a Giga Drowse. And we'll pass the turn. So still a pretty good spot for us, I want to say. Serum Visions from the opponent. Definitely fine with that. Let's see what they end up doing. Put card on bottom. Put card on bottom. Okay, so bottom. All right, this time Snapcaster goes after us again. Again, kind of interesting. All right, so we'll start off with Inquisition. All right, so let's take a Dictate. All right, so at this point, do we want to just get rid of their Snapcaster Mage? Yeah, you know what? Let's just play it safe. Let's get rid of their Snapcaster Mage. Let's go with Chandra here. And let's get some mana with Chandra. And let's get out a Ratchet Bomb. All right, so our opponent's definitely going to go end step Dictate. Then they'll be able to draw three cards. So we're going to have to fight through that. So now it's kind of a race to what's going to happen with our opponent's draws and with Chandra, I would say. And actually, the Blood Moon's doing a decent amount of work. So there's a Time Warp. Guess there's no need to put a counter on the Ratchet Bomb quite yet. So our opponent could get, you know, fairly lucky here and chain off a couple of Time Warp type effects. And it looks like they're doing it, so I think we played this game pretty well. I think we put ourselves in a spot where we're able to disrupt our opponent's process, our opponent's game plan. Our opponent could whiff out here. So opponent has 1, 2, 3, 4 Time Warp effects in the graveyard, along with one Snapcaster Mage. Wow, Part the Water Veil. Okay, that's the one that you normally don't want to see. on target land you control becomes a 0/0 elemental with haste. Huh. Did I probably missed what happened? To be honest, I'm just not going to sit here and lie to everybody. So, part the Waterfield. Didn't the opponent... Did the opponent not awaken? 9, 5, 6... So, this is... Okay. So... Again, slightly confused here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. All right, so our opponent didn't... Okay. All right, pretty simple. Again, guys, it is late here, but I'm gonna do everything I could in my power to stay with you guys. Our opponent just hard cast the Park the Water Veil. So I guess if our opponent just had one more land, but I guess they just couldn't wait because they couldn't pass the turn. Blood Moon gets bounced with a Cryptic Command. And our opponent Giga Drowse our Swamp. And I guess they're going to go for an Exhaustion here. That probably makes the most sense. Okay. Creatures and lands don't untap, so... Even though we don't get to untap, we do have Chandra to help us add some mana. Let's put a counter on the Ratchet Bomb. So there's a Koth, there's a Blood Moon, there's another Blood Moon. Okay, so unfortunately, we do not find a land in the three draws. Let's discard one of the Blood Moons. And let's take up Chandra. No, we're not going to cast the Night's Whisper. And then we'll pass the turn. So, pretty interesting. I think after sideboard, we're going to get much better in this matchup. We'll be able to take out a dead card like Ensnaring Bridge and go much more aggressive. Blood Moon isn't, you know, like I was saying, it's an okay card. It does help in certain spots, maybe when the opponent can't cast a Cryptic or it's just going to have less blue mana for their Giga Drowse. But our opponent's still with four cards in hand. Does our opponent just have nothing? Wow, our opponent just has nothing. This is awesome. This is really good. This is what I'm talking. People are talking, guys. All right, people are talking, and our opponent has nothing. All right, so let's start off. Let's go get another swamp while we're at it. Swamp. Let's see what our opponent has first. So probably the best line here is going to be start off with Thoughtseize. Let's start off with Thoughtseize. Wow, our opponent's just literal nothing. Okay, this is good. Let's get some mana. Let's play out Koth. Let's get a mountain here. Let's tick down. And let's get down Obnixilis. Let's draw a card. Ooh, relics could be pretty good here. Let's play relic. Let's blow relic. All right, let's tick up. Discard Blood Moon. All right, so I think we're in a pretty good spot. Maybe going on to three was a little ambitious there, but if our opponent bricks for one more turn, I think it's just game over. Uh-oh, is this part the Water Veil? It is part the Water Veil. No, no. Why, Gerard? Why? All right, so we probably messed up somewhere there, And I'm not going to think too much about it because we have to win this match. So let's just get the sideboarding. Is Snare and Bridge coming out? I think Blood Moon's got to come out. We definitely want Pack Rat. Definitely want Rabble Master. We definitely want Boil. Mage could be pretty good too. Relic's decent. Dreadbore. I'm going to say no with Dreadbore. Ratchet Bomb, yes. Liliana, yes. Koth, yes. Obnixilis. Huh. I can see an Obnixilis getting cut. I can see trimming on the relics. I think we want all the brutalities. Yeah, I like how this is. All right, let's submit this. So, kind of interesting, trying to think back. If we don't pay a life with Obnixilis, we're at 4. I mean, it doesn't even matter because the opponent just gets to take a second turn after the 6-6 is made. So, we're taking 6 and then taking 6 again. Was there a spot where we could have got down in Snaring Bridge? Maybe that's where we went wrong. Maybe we didn't value in Snaring Bridge at all. All right, this hand's pretty good, especially if our opponent doesn't have a ley line. It's like really good if they don't have a ley line. Just lead off with an Inquisition, and then follow it up with back-to-back Nice Whispers. All right, good. So no ley line from the opponent. So we just want to try to find a threat at this point. Let's go with Inquisition. And there's a Howling Mine and a Dictate. So we're going to take the Howling Mine. Right now our opponent cannot even cast the Dictate with the two lands they have in hand. All right, so I think we want to just thin out our deck as much as possible to try to find as many spells. So let's Night Whisper right here. Oh, nice. We got the Boil. What's going on, Boil? Let's see what it does. Destroy all islands when every reef is barred and every wave is dust. Only then shall I rest. All right, Boil. I like what you're saying. All right, so there's a Chandra. Pretty good pickup there. So let's go with Inquisition. And wow, our opponent just basically has nothing. This is probably going to be game over. Just because we're going to be able to Boil. So let's go with Nice Whispers again. Yeah, so like literally, I think we got him this game. So all right, yes. I'm going to go with Chandra here. Not going to be able to cast Chandra with that mana. Though, is Chandra the best line? Yeah, I think Chandra's the best line. Getting out Chandra is nice. All right, Chandra, tick up. Not going to cast the Rabble Master. Don't have the mana. So we'll deal 2 to the opponent, bring him back down to 20. So we know our opponent has Cryptic Command in hand. So this is going to be pretty nice. All right, so let's get 2 mana. Just so our opponent can't respond. Let's Thoughtseize. Our opponent's likely to Cryptic Command this. Probably counter, draw a card, and then we'll be able to Boil, and that should be it for this game. So likely going to a game 3 here. Basically on the back of Boil. What is up, Boil? All right, so that's fine. You know what? Let's slow roll a little bit more. Let's Inquisition the opponent. Why not? If you can slow roll, go for it. Wow, part Temporal Mastery. Okay, this will be a nice time to now play Boil. And our opponent's likely going to concede. Maybe not. Maybe they'll play it out. Again, Chandra, Koth, both Planeswalkers, Obnixilis. When you get that ultimate, it's a really nice feeling because you know you're so heavily favored to win that game. All right, so let's add some red to the pool. Let's play Koth. Let's add... Well, no, let's untap. Much better there. And let's play Mage. Take out the Radiant Fountain. And the next turn, Ultimate Chandra. So our opponent's sticking it out, though. So that's something you got to give him credit. All right, there's a Howling Mine. One. Two. So let's ultimate the Chandra. Let's get a collected brutality. Actually, maybe it's better just to go with Chandra here. Yeah, it's probably better just to get another Chandra. Red, red. Red, Chandra. We'll deal five to the opponent. Koth, untap the Blood Crypt. And then we'll swing in. So our opponent's down to nine. And next turn, we'll just be able to go spell and end the game. Let's see what our opponent saw. Did our opponent see any creatures yet? Opponent did not see any creatures. That's good news. All right, so our opponent plays Exhaustion on us, which is okay. Exile the top card, not going to cast it. Let's just untap the Blood Crypt. Instead of attacking, we'll Thoughtseize the opponent and deal them five with Chandra. That seems like a better line. Part, Temporal Mastery. All right, so this should be the last turn for the opponent. They'll draw two with Howling Mine, and very unlikely they'll be able to get out of this situation. And our opponent did not see any creatures yet, so I'm almost certain all the Fatal Pushes are out of the opponent's deck. So let's see if we want to do any sideboard changes. Relic has some value. Dreadbore, I mean, maybe, but like if we're trying to kill a land that's been awakened, you know, Fatal Push could do the job. But if the game gets to that point, it's just probably over already. Rabblemaster good, Liliana good, Ratchet Bomb good, Obnixilis, it's okay to be in the sideboard. Yeah, all right, so we're gonna run like this. Just thinking if we want the max relics just for like the cycle effect. But I think we need all our threats. Probably just better to have all our threats against a deck that, you know, does play counter spells. We have a lot of discards, so if our opponent does have white leyline in the sideboard, hopefully they do not draw it in their opening hand. Oh wow, our opening hand is really nice. Would be better with a one mana discard spell, but we'll definitely settle for what we have here. The only thing that could be tough if our opponent gets down a early Howling Mine. Okay, Inquisition. So nice that it's Inquisition and not a Thoughtseize, because the boil is definitely a really powerful effect against the opponent, and it's something that they have to be careful about. I could see our opponent taking any of the three cards here. I could see them taking Collective Brutality, Liliana of the Veil, or Pack Rat. It kind of depends on what's in their hand. So they do the Collective Brutality. Interesting. All right. So unfortunately, do not draw a one mana discard spell, which is probably our best draw there. Of course, on turn one. We definitely want to have a, you know, an Inquisition or a Thoughtseize at some point. Hopefully our opponent doesn't have a Shadow of Doubt. That would be really bad. Okay. All right, good. There's a mage. Mage is a pretty nice draw, actually. So we'll get down Pack Rat here, or we'll try to. So mage is pretty nice because we're able to, you know, disrupt our opponent land development rather than just having to play Liliana. Liliana is good, but sometimes Liliana gets like overpowered by the Howling Mind or the Dictate. So, interesting. Our opponent Echoing Truths are Pack Rat. Maybe they're going for an exhaustion here. That would be... Yeah, okay. So our opponent does go for exhaustion. Yeah, probably a small mistake. Actually, before I drew the Thoughtseize, should have been more careful with how I played out my mana. Because if I held the Swamp, I would have been able to go Swamp Thoughtseize. And that was actually something that I considered, but after the fact. So something you could definitely learn from here. Could be a costly mistake. We'll see. All right, so let's Thoughtseize here. Totally fine if a Cryptic Command happens. If a Cryptic Command does happen here, it's interesting between Liliana and the Mage. I think maybe trying to keep our opponent off mana might be better. So it's just Cryptic counter draw. Okay. What we thought might be the case. So, you know what? I think Mage is actually just better because I want to keep all my cards in hand. Yeah, I think Mage is better. It shuts off our opponent just going, you know, land Time Warp. Not that land Time Warp's that great, but let's take out the Water Grave. So the Sunken Hollow is both an island and swamp. Same thing with Water Grave. So not sure if it matters taking out the Sunken Hollow or the Water Grave. Maybe Liliana is slightly better to just take it up to 4. But I didn't really want to discard anything, so... All right, so let's get down Pack Rat. And then I think going for Liliana here is pretty good. And then Boil could always be, you know, an end of a turn effect. Some may argue to just hold up Boil, but I think developing our game by developing the board is much better here. So Liliana, tick up. Let's discard Blood Crypt. Let's see what our opponent discards. Okay, so our opponent discards an Inquisition. Interesting. Okay, so there's a Dictate. All right, totally fine with that, actually. As long as our opponent doesn't go off this turn, I think we're going to win. I think we're in too good of a spot with Liliana and Boil. So this is probably the big turn here. Exhaustion could be kind of bad for us. Of course, the worst would probably just be like land Time Warp. And they could just really chain up. But if we get out of this turn, I think we're good. All right, so our opponent cracking the Flooded Strand for an island. So there's Snapcaster Exhaustion. Okay, that was something that definitely I considered could have happened, but, you know, it gets to a point, what can you really do? All right, so let's tick up Liliana. Let's discard Obnixilis. Not going to be doing too much here. All right, so we're looking to dodge for another turn. And, you know, if we do dodge for one turn, it's just game over. So is this just a part? Okay, that's fine. So our opponent gets two more chances. Let's go. Come on. Miss. You know, it's like, you know, I don't want to be mean, but sometimes, you know, when you're playing, not me, I'm not going to say I do it. I'm not even going to talk about it. Miss. All right, let's see. Our opponent just with one card in hand. So, I mean, this is it right here. If our opponent doesn't have another time walk effect or doesn't have something, I mean, because we'll be able to tick up Liliana and then boom, Boyle, just, you know, crippling our opponent's mana base, getting it down to, you know, two lands. So we'll be in an excellent spot. Just destroying their game plan, destroying their mana base. So our opponent hasn't done anything yet. So just a quick recap while our opponent is thinking. Round one, we defeated Valakit. Unfortunately, that was not covered, but we started off 1-0 by defeating Valakit. Round two, played against Blue White Control. All right, so Dictate is on the stack, so it looks pretty good for us. Let's go. Could our opponent have like a Cryptic here and then try to... Yeah, let's just... Possibly a Snapcaster. Any point... Yeah, maybe it's better to get Relic down here. Possibly a... All right, so let's go with Relic before we do anything. Our opponent is thinking here. And then the last round that we won, we played against Black Widow Eldrazi. So Valakit, Blue-White Control, Black-White Eldrazi, now against the Blue-Black Time Warp deck, or Taking Turns deck, I think it's called. So definitely diverse. I'm telling you, if you guys are planning to attend a Modern tournament, it's pretty difficult to say, you know what, I think I'm going to play against two Affinity decks, two Tron decks, a Burn deck. You could really just play against anything. So let's tick up Liliana. Plan is to discard the Night's Whisper, which is good, but we don't need to hear because our main plan is to try to just get the Boyle to resolve. I just love Boyle as a card. It's just like so powerful, and it really punishes those blue mages. What's up, blue mages? You guys are going down. Let's go, Blood. Let's go, Boyle. I do like Blood Moon too. So in the last video, I played Teemer Moon. Blood Moon, definitely excellent. I think Blood Moon's actually better in this deck just because it's a two-color deck and your actual game plan to win could be Blood Moon. In the Teemer Moon deck, you could win off Blood Moon, but normally it's just there for some disruption and you're trying to win with the Snapcaster, Tarmogoyf, etc. So our opponent is deep in the tank here. Maybe... I'm not really too sure what they could have. So, still an exciting match, you know. Game one was a long game, I would say, and a game with a good amount of decisions. We ended up losing. So, all right, awesome. So, I did read the opponent for Snapcaster Mage. So, since our opponent has no cards in hand, we might as well just crack... Yeah, I mean, just crack the Relic and... Yeah, sure. I mean, it's not too much of a difference here. Crack Relic and Boil. So, This has to be pretty good for us. Probably should have just boiled first, then cracked relic, but... All right, probably don't need... Yeah, we'll hold on to the Night's Whisper. So we'll discard Bloodstained Mire. And definitely in a good spot here. So our opponent does have two Snapcaster Mages, but other than that, just really don't have too much. The Dictate actually heavily benefits us just because we have such more... You know, we have much more mana than the opponent. They only have two mana, and we have six. So, both Snapcasters likely to attack Liliana. Liliana goes down to two. I want to keep the Pack Rat around. Since this turn, we could just go Pack Rat. Pack Rat. All right, so let's tick up Liliana. Actually, I've discarded the Night's Whispers. Not going to matter too much because this is going to be our exact plan. We're just going to go Pack Rat and then Pack Rat again. Even though getting caught down would be pretty nice, given that we have six lands and that our opponent is on 15, just next turn, it's just lethal. So our opponent's going to be forced to either... You know, top deck into an exhaustion or leave back both Snapcaster Mages and Chump Block. So our opponent's at 12 now. Echoing Truth could be a thing, so that was something to consider. There's an exhaustion. We talked about that. There's an Inquisition. There's a Mage. So let's tick up Liliana. Let's discard Inquisition. All right, let's just get in with both Pack Rats. All right, so our opponent takes it, and they're playing to their out of Echoing Truth, which is definitely the correct line. I still think that even our opponent does, or even if our opponent did top deck Echoing Truth, we're still favored to win this. All right, looks like our opponent did not. So there's a Collective Brutality. There's a Chandra. So definitely good. So let's have our opponent sacrifice one of the Snapcaster Mages. Let's go for a Collective Brutality on the other Snapcaster Mage. And then this forces our opponent, if they do have Crypta Command, to have to tap our team now, which would open up the spot for Chandra to resolve. And it looks like our opponent has nothing. So, wow. All right. So, we are 4-0 with the Black-Red Bridgewalker deck. It's into the next morning. It's 12:14. But, of course, we're going to finish this off and try to go for the 5-0. I like this deck a lot. I definitely, put a good amount of work into it. And we'll be back for round 5 and see what happens. All right, guys. Thanks for watching. It's Gerard Fabiano for Channel Fireball. So, one more round to go. Let's do it. All right, guys, what's going on? Gerard Fabiano here. This is round 5. So the final round, we are 5-0. I'm getting ahead of myself. Again, this is round 5. We are 4-0. I need to do all these videos around like 6 at night is probably good. And all right, looks like this person knows me. Yes. Hi, how are you? Recording for Channel Fireball. Good luck. Thank you. Nice. All right. So our opponent's streaming. So he says he's a big fan. So shout out to our opponent. And this should be a good match. So we're going to keep our hand. Hand's okay. Not the best. Double Koth with an Inquisition. Is our opponent playing Elves? No. Okay. So far, Search for Tamar. Our opponent is playing Valakut. So this was actually... the first matchup we played, you guys didn't get to see it because unfortunately it wasn't recorded, but the next 4 matches were, this is the final one. Let's get a Swamp here. Let's go for an Inquisition. And Anger of Gods, Primeval Titan, and Farseek. So Anger of Gods not going to do anything. Primeval Titan will. So we're going to have to try to get to a Thoughtseize, or we're going to have to try to get down an Ensnaring Bridge before Primeval Titan comes down. And I guess we're just going to have to keep trying to thin out our deck. That's probably the best line. Blood Moon obviously is excellent in this matchup. I think the matchup favors us, like I said earlier, and, well, if I didn't say it earlier, I meant to say it. I think the matchup does favor us. Just this draw, not the best for us, but I don't think it's a hand that we could mulligan, especially against an unknown opponent. So let's sack the Marsh Flats, or an unknown deck, I should say. Blood Moon one time. Ooh, and Snaring Bridge. Snaring Bridge. Okay, let's get Bloodstained Mire. Let's sack that. So now that we have the Ensnaring Bridge, we're going to have to worry about Scapeshift. So we got the Primeval Titan covered. Next turn, we'll be able to play Chandra, tick up. But it's probably the best line, right? Chandra, tick up. Chandra, tick up, sack Relic, or is it Koth? Get in. I think Chandra. I think we want to get the Chandra here. Especially with the Relic, we'll be able to cycle. At this point, we're really looking for a Blood Moon. All right, so our opponent responds. Okay, so Inquisition. Not too good for us here. So our opponent's going to be able to go land Primeval Titan. So we're on 17. All right, so there's the Titan. It can't attack, but it's going to probably fetch up two Valakits here, which is bad news for us. So we probably only have... I mean, there's a chance that we just need to hit Blood Moon this turn. All right, that is not a Blood Moon. I'm trying to think if we want to shock ourselves. In case we Chandra and hit an Obnixilis. Unlikely, so... Let's just flip the top card. Another Ensnaring Bridge. Don't even want to cast it. Let's Inquisition just to see what the opponent has. Then we can decide whether or not we're going to pay two life from Blood Crypt for the Koth. All right, so not the worst. What if Foothills is going to be able to deal us 6 damage, however. So I'm trying to think if we want to stay at a slightly higher life total. Taking the Omen's pretty good. That was definitely good. Koth goes up to 4. There's just no way that we're going to be able to race with Koth. So I think... We just can't afford to pay the 2 life. That might be a bad line, but given the fact that our opponent has just a Wood of Foothills for action, I mean, I think preserving our life total might be a bit better. They're going to take out Chandra this turn, which is okay. I mean, I'm pretty sure they're just going after Chandra. That probably makes the most sense. Yeah. Okay, so Chandra's hitting the bin here. We're desperately going to need to find a Blood Moon. Ooh, okay, another Chandra. That's pretty good. So at this point, I think playing Koth. Let's get down the Blood Crypt here. Let's add 4 red. Let's Chandra... Let's flip the top card. There's an Inquisition. I mean, it's so unlikely our opponent has... I mean, we know they have Anger of Gods, but that's just not doing anything. Is the two damage going to be more relevant? Probably not, so let's just Inquisition our opponent. All right, so we take Anger. Unfortunately, they have a Misty. So, be able to take out Chandra? I don't know. This is definitely a tough game. Uh-oh. Our opponent's tapping some mana. Secure Tribe Elder. Well, we are at 17, which makes me feel a little bit better about things. But again, this is just like, if we draw Blood Moon, it's game over. Okay, we win. But we have 41 cards still in our deck. We have 3 Blood Moons. So for all the math people out there, definitely a close game. And I'm happy that we get to showcase this deck against the Valakut deck, because that's what we played against round one. And unfortunately, we didn't get to record it, but I'm guessing that the opponent is just going to be taking out the Planeswalkers. The other issue is that it might get to a point where we don't really have... Well, I guess that's not going to matter, because Blood Moon, if Blood Moon comes down, we'll definitely find a way to win. Huh. So a swamp's not going to really help us. So we'll tick up Koth and then just pass the turn. The problem is that our opponent's draws are just much more alive against, you know, in this particular spot. It's just like everything is like deal 6 damage. And if this is Escape Shift, it should just be game here. Yeah, so it is Escape Shift. I'm guessing our opponent does have the correct number of mountains left in their deck. And we're likely to be down a game. So looking forward to sideboarding. I think that Ensnaring Bridge does have some merit, but I think boarding into the more aggressive package is what we want to do. We definitely want 3 mages. We, you know, almost certainly are going to go the pack route, Goblin Rabblemaster route. So I think we'll be able to do okay after sideboard. Yeah, so that's definitely enough. So we'll just concede here, and we'll get to go to sideboard. All right, so Fatal Push not going to do too much for us. Pack Rat, yes. Mage, yes. Rabblemaster, yes. Olivia, yeah, because we're going to take out the bridges. We're going to take out all the relics. Want to leave Ratchet Bomb in, just in case of a ley line. It could have some other use there. I think taking out one Obnixilus is probably just too good against Titan. I think taking out 2 Brutalities is okay. Brutality's not going to really do too much. It's just slightly worse than the Thought Seizes and Inquisitions for the most part. Brutality could hit Scape Shift where Inquisition can't. But I think considering that we'll still have 10, you know, spot discard along with 2 Lilianas, the Blood Moons, the Mages, I think this looks pretty good. So we're going to go with this configuration. And we'll be on the play for game 2. Hopefully, you know, we have a pretty good draw. Something with a discard spell followed up by, you know, either a Knight's Whispers or a Pack Rat. Maybe a Pack Rat that gets some pressure. But basically our sweet spot against this deck really falls into 3 drop category. Liliana is good. You know, they could have something like an Obstinate Baloth. Still, Liliana is powerful. Blood Moon, of course, could be game-changing. Rabblemaster, if they don't have an answer, will just come down very quickly if we get it on turn 3, and it really does a lot of damage. And then, you know, of course, the extra copies of the 3 mages here, they're nice because you could normally just hold on to them or keep them in play and then wait to hit the Valakut. So we'll be on the play here. Ooh, unfortunately, we're going to have to take a mulligan in a key spot. And this hand is okay, so we'll keep. There is an Inquisition. So do we want the Inquisition? Do we have time for Inquisition? I'm actually going to say no. I'm going to say, you know, we're going to have to go Thoughtseize Pack Rat, and our plan just might be to try to hit another land. So, okay. Beast Within, Primeval Titan, Tireless Tracker, Wood Elves. So, normally this deck does board into Tireless Trackers. We still have, you know, answers for that, so I'm not too concerned. I think we're just going to have to take the Secure Tribe Elder. Yeah, not really liking our spot, to be honest. The mulligan was pretty bad. You know, maybe there's some merit to draw in this matchup. I know it's kind of crazy, and it's very, very specific matchups where people do that. But all right, so get the Marsh Flats. Probably going to have to get a Blood Crypt since we have some double red. There's Pack Rat. I don't know if we'll be able to, you know, power through. Our opponent does have Beast Within, Wood Elves in hand. Tireless Tracker, I'm less concerned about. We're already at 15. Ooh, there's a Rabble Master. Jeez. All right. I don't think I want to go to 12. So unlikely is just Chandra at this point, really, in Koth. So I think we just need to get Rabble Master down. All right, so we'll get in for some damage here, but not in love with our spot still. And of course, just, you know, one Anger of Gods away from us just basically packing it in. Not saying our opponent still has Anger of Gods in the deck. It's likely they do not. Oh, wow. So our opponent missed on a land. Wow, pretty crazy. Pretty crazy. At this point, do we just want to go? I think we just want to get rid of the Obnixilis. Next zone, maybe go. And I want to get rid of the Pack Rat. Yeah, so let's get rid of the Pack Rat. Let's get in there for all the damage that we could. All right, so could be going to a game three if our opponent bricks off here. Yes, our opponent does brick off here. All right, so we're going to a game three. That was on the mulligan. All right, so we're going to be on the draw. Our opponent, we know, has Tireless Tracker. I mean, is Collective Brutality always going to kill Tireless Tracker? Do we want to try to mess with Fatal Push? You know, we do have some of the fetch lands. Let's see. Inquisition, definitely need. Thoughtseize, definitely need. This might just be a good way for you guys to go over how you want to sideboard. Maybe Koth is not good enough here. You know, Koth is nice game one with Blood Moon. But we are on the draw. Maybe minus a Koth for a Brutality. That might be okay. All right, that's what I'm going to go with. I like everything else. All right, so game three, we're playing for a 5-0. Pretty crazy. If you guys, you know, have any suggestions about this deck, if you guys like this video, I do try to walk through a lot of the plays. I want to try to walk through my thought process. Sometimes it is difficult to always play the best you could play and discuss everything's going on. But I think that we do a pretty good job together on it. So I'm liking how a lot of these videos are turning out. And, you know, we are 4-0 going to game three. And, you know, on the chance, if we do 5-0, we're definitely cracking those treasure chests on camera. Ooh. All right. So let's think about this. Ratchet Bomb, probably not too good, but kind of a safety net for like a ley line. Chandra, it's a bit slow, and a Knight's Whisper. A part of me wants to mulligan this, but we are in the draw. We have four lands, so we're able to cast, you know, all our spells, and we have the Knight's Whisper. I'm actually going to keep, not in love with it, especially in game three, but, you know, sometimes you gotta, you know, whatever you get, you gotta try to work with. So we'll keep. Let's see what our first draw is. Ooh, first draw is a mountain. Not very good here. So we'll go with Bloodstained Mire and pass the turn. I mean, we could mulligan and go to six. The whole reason I'm keeping is Knight's Whisper. If you think about it, we're on the draw with the Knight's Whisper. We have a few more chances at Blood Moon, which is just so key in this matchup. So here, I think it's okay to just get a Blood Crypt. All right, let's see what we draw here. Okay, there's a Mage. Decent. Definitely decent. Let's go with Marsh Flats. Thin out our deck a bit. Let's get a Swamp. And let's Nice Whisper. All right, so not really what we're looking for. At this point, we could discard the Blood Crypt. So in a pretty bad spot, I would say, but that also does come down to, you know, the hand that we kept. So we can't complain too much. We just have to try to work with what we have here. And the best line might just be, I mean, Ratchet Bomb does hit Omen for sure. So that's another thing to consider. Uh-oh, that's bad for us. That's really bad. Chandra not going to do it for us here. So maybe this was a mulligan. You know, I'm sure most people in hindsight will say, yeah, you know, that was obviously a mulligan. All right, let's think here. We're not going to do anything at the end of turn, but on their upkeep. Let's see if we're going to do anything. All right, so our opponent's sacking the Secure Tribe Elder, which is bad for us. This also means that we're definitely going to have to use the Mage here, I believe. Just, you know, land, Scapeshift, we could respond. Could our opponent just have Primeval Titan and nothing else? Let's think this through. Can we keep the Mage in play? Keep the Mage in play for Valakid. Yeah, I think we're going to have to keep the Mage in play. Not do anything on the upkeep. Yeah, it's so unlikely for our opponent only to have Primeval Titan in hand and not another land. So I'd rather just have the Mage in play. But again, we're, you know, threading on pretty thin ice, I want to say. Just another Bloodstained Mire. Not what we were hoping for. All right. We'll get in there for two with the Mage. I'd rather stay at 16 than 15. All right, let's get a Chandra out there. Let's just add two red. Let's get out Ratchet Bomb. Could have some use for, like, something weird like a Beast Within. Two damage might have been slightly more relevant, but at this point, it's kind of like Blood Moon or Bust. We're going to have to try to dodge for one more turn. So our opponent is cycling. Yeah, our opponent cycles Sweltering Suns. Okay. All right, so Sweltering Suns has been cycled. All right, so at this point, I think putting a counter on Ratchet Bomb might be a bit better because of Omen. All right, there's a Night's Whisper. So let's start off with Night's Whisper. Let's draw some cards. No Blood Moon, okay. Let's play out Swamp. That does bring us below 15. Let's go with another Night's Whisper. Ooh, and there's the Blood Moon. Wow. Okay. This is pretty crazy. So our opponent could definitely have Beast Within. All right, let's go for the attack. So our opponent's at 15. Our opponent could have Beast Within. Our opponent could have Scapeshift. Couple of plays here. Take up Chandra. Play Blood Moon. That's one option. Other option is Thoughtseize and then deal two. I'm trying to think what the opponent could have in hand. Well, I think I'm going to go with the Thoughtseize. Let's see if this pans out or not. All right. So Lightning Bolt. Wow, this is bad. So our opponent also had the Nature's Claim. This is pretty bad. So our opponent has Lightning Bolt, Primeval Titan, Scapeshift. Can we get out of this? So, if we take the Lightning Bolt, I think we have to take the Lightning Bolt here. So, Scapeshift, our opponent sacks everything. One, two. So a land would just be really bad for us. Huh. So we're trying to fade a lot. Primeval Titan is bad for us too. Wow. Oh my. This is bad. So Lightning Bolt. No, we can't take the Lightning Bolt. That's for sure. So we just have to take the Primeval Titan? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So we're going to have to fade so much. Okay. If we take the Primeval Titan. Wow, this is tough. So I'm definitely going to need some time here. The Nature's Claim really throws a wrench in it, right? If we take the Nature's Claim, we're just going to lose to the Titan most likely, right? Then again, we could go Chandra. Can't go Chandra. All right, so I think we have to take the Titan. And then we're going to have to try to hit another discard spell in the form of Collective Brutality and hope the opponent doesn't hit land. All right, so this is pretty bad for us. Let's deal the opponent two. All right, that was just a Marsh Flats. And then we'll pass the turn. All right, so we need our opponent to brick on land. Right? We just need them to brick on land. If they bolt, if they hit land, so they'll have eight lands. Hold on. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I think we have to mage now and hope they brick on lands. Because if they hit land, they go bolt. We kill the stomping ground. Then they just go skit six mountains and a Valakid. Yeah. Okay, so we'll take out the stomping ground. And we just need them to brick on land. So, all right. Well, regardless, we had a good run. Hopefully no land. And, all right, they hit their land, and that's it for us. Okay, so that's what we needed them to do, was not to hit on land. I think that was the only line we could have taken. Because, maybe not. Maybe we messed that up. So if they bolt, I think it would have been the same thing. All right, well, we've lost. It is almost 1 o'clock in the morning. We did pretty well with the deck. I wanted to showcase what the deck was. The strategy of the video, I don't think it was as powerful as the Teemer Moon one, but I think that it's made up by the archetype of the deck and the way the deck tries to attack the opponent. Definitely an interesting run right here. Good games to our opponent. We're going to still crack those treasure chests on camera, see what we get. What did our opponent have in the graveyard, by the way? No other Valakid. So, all right, definitely interesting match. Thank you for watching. So we'll just concede to save some time here. And we did go 4-1, so I think we get like, all right, so eight treasure chests, excuse me, not too bad here. So let's go to collection. And we're just going to crack them right away. And we'll open all of these. So let's see what we get. Hopefully something good. Last time wasn't too good. So 40 play points. Okay. Nice. An Arid Mesa Expedition. An Elspeth. That's much better than last time. Not too sure what that is. All right. Well, you know, can't be too greedy. Elspeth, pretty nice. Probably worth about 2 tickets. And the Arid Maces, maybe that's like 9. But regardless, the deck itself, I'll bring it up one more time so you guys could take one final look at it. Here is Modern, Bridgewalkers. So this was a deck that we played. And I don't think that I would change anything as of now. I think if you guys want to play this deck, give it a try like this. The deck does have a lot of decisions, you know. Definitely has a lot of should it mulligan, should it keep. That last match was pretty tough against Valakid. We lost in a close game 3, but you know, you can't be really unhappy when you go 4-1 and you learn something and you definitely have fun playing the deck. So I am Gerard Fabiano. Thank you for watching. It's much appreciated. And make sure you guys leave a comment down below. I know some of you guys wanted to see a Sultai Modern deck. Maybe I'll do that. So whatever next Modern deck you might want to see, let me know, and I'll do my best to make sure that I make a video for you guys. So again, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time. What's up, guys? Gerard Fabiano here for a bonus round. So what happened was, in the previous league, we ended up going 4-1. Unfortunately, round 1 did not record. So then I hopped into a new league, and once again, I didn't record round 1, but then I thought, hey, we should give the people what they want. I want to give you guys out there a 5th round with the Black Red Bridgewalker deck. So that's what we're going to do here. We're going to play one additional round. We'll call it the bonus round. Hopefully we'll win, and we'll see how things go. All right, so opening hand is actually pretty similar to the hand that we ended up keeping against Valakid in match 5, game 3. I talked to some people. Some said maybe I should have mulliganed. Some thought maybe I should have kept. I would love to hear what you guys think. And we will keep this hand. We're against an unknown deck. Opponent leads off with a mountain. So it could mean a couple of different things, but an Inquisition is an excellent draw there. So let's Inquisition our opponent. It would be funny if it's against Valakid again, like a rematch. All right. So Genesis Chamber. Whenever a non-token creature enters the battlefield, if Genesis Chamber is untapped, that creature's controller creates a 1-1 colorless mer artifact creature. All right, pretty interesting. So our opponent leads off with a mountain. So I guess the Genesis Chamber is probably their plan. That's why they decided not to run out the Champion of Parish. So, never saw this deck before, and the whole thing about Modern is that the format's really great, that you can play against the variety of 20 to 40 different decks at any given tournament, and I would probably say between 20 and 40 decks could be considered competitive, and even though I never seen this deck before, it's something cool. So I think this is a good bonus round video, but I'm going to take the Genesis Chamber. I don't want anything to get out of hand with that. As far as those creatures go, I think we could handle those creatures with our removal, Ensnaring Bridge, Ratchet Bomb, etc. And there is a Champion of Parish and a Norrin the Wari. When a player casts a spell or creature, attacks, exile, return it to the battlefield under its controllers. All right, really, really interesting deck, to be honest. So we're going to get out a Ratchet Bomb. I think a Ratchet Bomb could be pretty good here. And I honestly have to say I've never seen this deck before. So if this is a deck that's known, I do apologize because I've never seen it before. But that is a pretty cool interaction right there. The Champion of Parish could get pretty big pretty fast. Most likely the Ajani Pride Mate will be coming out here. All right. So we'll be taking some damage from the Champion of the Parish. Put a counter on the Ratchet Bomb. And I'm pretty sure we need to blow the bomb on our turn for one. This will trigger. Their creature will come back. All right, so before we play any spell, I think we have to blow the bomb for one. I believe that's the correct line. Wow. Okay, total mistake on my part. We did know the opponent had the lightning bolt, so totally not a good play there. I told myself, Gerard, it's the bonus round. You have to play as best as possible for everybody out there. And I don't know. I don't know what's going on, but our opponent is going to be able to save their Norrin the Wari. And this is a good lesson because when you are playing against a deck that is, you know, pretty unknown, it's better to try to play as safe and slow as possible. So that's what we'll do from here on out. Nothing we can do now. You just got to try to tighten up. We'll go for a Night's Whisper. And we do find a Chandra, which is going to be pretty good. So we did know about the Lightning Bolt. All right, so there's another Champion of the Parish. We'll take two from the Ajani Pride Maid. We'll go get a Blood Crypt, not paying the two life. And I think probably, well, we'll see what we draw, that's for sure. Relic. Relic's probably not going to do too much here. So I think we have to just try to do what we can to take care of our opponent's creatures. So Chandra's going to come down. We're going to have to minus Chandra to take out the Champion. So deal four to the Champion. Our opponent's down to one card in hand, which is pretty good. And this could just basically almost never attack. So it's okay that we lost a Chandra because now we'll be able to play Obnixilis here. So let's filter through black-black. We'll get down the Obnixilis. And I just want to take out the Ajani Pride Mate right now. So we'll do that. Obnixilis will go to two, but we'll be safe from the opponent's creature as Norrin the Wari won't be able to attack the Obnixilus. And hopefully we could pull ahead with some card advantage. So let's start by drawing a card. All right, opponent has three cards in hand. I'm fine with playing an Inquisition here. Just see what the opponent's up to. All right, so Path to Exile, another Norrin the Wari. So I'm just going to take the Path to Exile so our opponent won't be able to path their own creature. We are an 8. Let's play Relic. Let's just cycle Relic now. So we're able to cantrip. Thoughtseize. Don't really want to play a Thoughtseize. But then again, our opponent does have Ranger, so I'm trying to think if we're able to Ensnaring Bridge and get to a point. Now, I think we're going to have to play the Thoughtseize. So we'll be down to 6 from the Thoughtseize, but taking the Ranger is pretty important. And at this point, we're probably looking for something like a Collective Brutality just to, you know, gain a couple of life so we would be able to dodge some lightning bolts from our opponent, any burn spells. There's another Obnixilus. So I'm going to be a little bit greedy here. I'm going to draw with this Obnixilus. Then I'm going to play the new Obnixilus. We'll keep this one. Let's draw again. At this point, I'm just not even going to be playing around lightning bolt. So if our opponent does end up drawing a lightning bolt, there's not much we could do unless we find a Collective Brutality. Okay, interesting. There's a Worship. So if you control a creature, damage that would reduce to you is reduced to 1 instead. Wow, this deck's pretty awesome. I do have to say. All right, so we'll draw again with Obnixilus. And Obnixilus ultimate's at 8, so we'll be able to go down to 2. I guess at this point, we don't want to get down in Snaring Bridge, I don't think. Dreadbore. Night's Whisper we can't cast. All right, so we'll just pass the turn here. And again, this is definitely a cool deck, so maybe we could do a video article on this deck. All right, there's Obnixilus. Once again, we'll tick up and draw. So we're on 2, and at this point, it's going to be a race. If our opponent finds a burn spell, we will be in trouble. The only way we could kind of dodge that is by getting to a Collective Brutality first. All right, so we just ultimated Obnixilus, and we will pass the turn. So the Obnixilus actually gets around the Worship because the Obnixilus says target opponent will lose the 2 life. So, all right, there's Champion of Perish. Not too concerned about that since we still have removal in hand. So Chandra's pretty nice. So, oh, that's starting the draw step. So Obnixilus trigger. Of course, works for both players, so there's a stop on the draw step. So let's lead off with Dreadbore on the Champion of Perish. And we could filter some red here. Let's play out Chandra. Again, we're just trying to end the game as quick as possible. Let's exile our top card. Just a swamp, so we'll pass the turn. Again, we have to dodge Lightning Bolt for about 3 turns, I would say. Maybe just 2 fades right now. All right, let's exile our top card. Thoughtseize. We are not casting Thoughtseize. That's for certain. All right, so this is basically the last turn. We just have to dodge the lightning bolt. We are on two. Opponent just plays a Sacred Foundry. Opponent will be down to four. Let's tick up Chandra. Just hit a Blood Crypt and do... Okay, it doesn't even matter. Our opponent concedes. All right, so we win game one. And we're playing against a pretty crazy deck. So, Ensnaring Bridge I don't think is very good. Blood Moon I don't think is very good in this matchup. And Relic didn't really seem too good. But that's what we're taking out. Let's see what we're bringing in. Definitely the three Fatal Pushes. Definitely the four Pack Rats. When you're changing strategies, the Olivia's coming in. Goblin Rabble Master's coming in. That's 59, so we need one more card. And I think bringing in one Mage could be okay. Our opponent did have a handful of non-basics. Not really going to do too much. The Relic's not going to really do too much either. I don't really see the Ensnaring Bridge being great, especially with our new sideboard plan. So it's basically, do we want a cantrip in the form of Relic? Or do we want one copy of Mage? I'm just going to go with one copy of Mage. All right, so again, this is Gerard Fabiano for Channel Fireball. This is the bonus round. And bonus round indeed, since we are playing against a pretty out there deck. But game one, we almost lost. We had to dodge Lightning Bolt. So in game two, our opening hand is good, but only one land. So we're going to take a mulligan here. And our five-card hand is pretty bad, but we do have Collective Brutality, which could act as multiple spells by killing a creature and making our opponent discard one of their instants or sorcery. So we're actually going to keep Marsh Flask. We do not want, since we are, you know, basically flooded here. But I'm okay with keeping this. Obviously not ideal, but would rather keep five lands with the Collective Brutality rather than just mulliganing down to five. All right, good. Ratchet Bomb is a nice pickup there. Again, when you just scry something to the bottom, you normally do not want to use a Bloodstained Mire early, since you don't want that card because you scry that card to the bottom. So you want to have, you know, a zero chance of drawing that particular copy of that card. Okay, so our opponent does cast Genesis Chamber. That's something we're definitely going to have to get rid of with Ratchet Bomb because of the nice interaction with Norrin the Wari. So let's get down a mountain. And let's just get down the Ratchet Bomb right now. So I could see this matchup being pretty difficult, especially when the opponent gets Genesis Chamber going. And maybe this deck is pretty real. So maybe a nice speculation could be on Genesis Chamber. I know it's only an uncommon, but, you know, we've seen uncommon cards hit up to, you know, a few dollars for sure. Even more. All right, so the Merge are coming in. They really are. And this is pretty tough spot for us. Let's put a charge counter on the Ratchet Bomb. I'm not going to blow the Ratchet Bomb for zero, since we're just going to have to try to do something to the Merge anyway, because we're not going to be able to beat this if Ratchet Bomb just kills the tokens. Ratchet Bomb would then only be a temporary answer, which is something that we need a permanent answer to. So our opponent with three cards in hand. Huh. Pretty tough spot. If we blow the bomb and our opponent has anything, it's pretty bad. If we wait on the bomb for two, we're probably just dying to the champion. It's so likely that our opponent has something, though. That's unfortunate. So let's go with Collective Brutality. And let's go all three modes. So escalate with three modes, target opponent, the champion, and let's discard one, two. All right, so Nor and the Wari will get exiled temporarily. Huh, okay. So these are some pretty crazy cards. Mark of Asylum. Prevent all non-combat damage that would be dealt to creatures you control. And Suppression Field. Activated abilities cost two more to activate unless they are mana abilities. Okay. So opponent doesn't have an instant or sorcery in hand. And we'll just use the Bloodstained Mire right now. So I think we are in a pretty good spot again. Maybe I'm giving just too much credit to this deck. Our opponent will be able to get in for five. Then we'll be able to take care of the Genesis Chamber, which is pretty important. So at this point, we're only going to have to worry about handling the 5/1/1 tokens, which hopefully we'll be able to do. Oh, wow. Okay, Purpuros. So, as long as your devotion to red is less than five, it's not a creature. All right, so creatures you control. Wow, this is actually going to be pretty bad. Maybe we shouldn't have put that counter on the Ratchet Bomb. That's something that I spoke about earlier. And again, this is definitely a learning lesson for all of us, especially myself playing against this deck. Maybe if we kept the bomb, I'm not too sure, but at this point, we're going to have to take up the Ratchet Bomb to two to take out the Genesis Chamber. And we're going to be taking a good amount of damage here. We're going to fall down to 14. So we're going to need something to get out of this. A second Ratchet Bomb would be amazing, of course. Chandra's not really going to do it for us. We could blow the bomb, get rid of the Genesis Chamber, and then our opponent can basically just kill us. So we'll concede this game. We'll go to a game three. Pretty wild. Pretty wild, to be honest. All right, so back to sideboard. Maybe we do need an ensnaring bridge, but again, it just goes so poorly with our strategy after board. Definitely don't want Relic. Blood Moon, no. Boil, no. All right, I'm going to leave it alone, and I'm just going to hope that, you know, we just get a turn one Inquisition or Thoughtseize, take that Genesis Chamber and not have to worry about it. And our hand is good. Bazam. Our hand is powerful, and our opponent's mulligan to the six. All right, let's and our opponent's mulligan to the five. What's up, bonus round? All right. So we'll lead off with a Swamp and an Inquisition. All right, so this deck I'm definitely intrigued with. All right, what tutor is it? Search your library for an enchantment card, reveal it, and put it into your hand, then shuffle your library, and then double Soul Warden. Wow. Are we worried about the tutor? Search your library for an enchantment. That's pretty slow. I think I would rather take one of the Soul Wardens. And our plan is just to go Pack Rat on him. All right. Ooh, a Champion of the Parish. Okay. So our opponent does have the Soul Warden in hand. So that's going to change a few things. I'm going to actually go with the Inquisition here. Take that Soul Warden. And I would rather have the Champion of the Parish not grow. So I'm fine with taking one here. I'm fine with, you know, being a little slower with Pack Rat, given we have two Planeswalkers in hand. All right, so there's a Thoughtseize. So might as well continue with the discard strategy. We'll take the tutor, and we'll play Pack Rat. And that's another thing that's interesting when you have an option when you're playing a discard deck. This is going to be a pretty good lesson. Sometimes it's just better to take the lower casted card in the opponent's hand, because then you'll have a chance to draw another discard spell to take the card that they could not yet cast. So just something to think of there. All right, so there's an Obnixilis. At this point, getting in the with pack rat would be pretty nice. I think I actually don't want Koth here. I think I would rather have Obnixilus than Koth. But we'll see. We should have made a token with the pack rat. I was definitely talking to you guys and clicked through the attack. So that is unfortunate. Prevent all non-combat damage that will be dealt to creatures you control. Okay, basically doesn't really do too much. You know, it does shut off Chandra if we wanted to try to use Chandra. But we're going to discard Koth here. Get another token with pack rat. Our opponent will gain a life with the Soul's Attendance, which is okay. Again, our opponent is on the mulligan to 5 this game. So, ooh, there's another pack rat, so that's pretty good. All right, this time we're going to get in. And we're not going to miss out on making a rat. And at this point, I think actually getting rid of the Obnixilus is fine. So our opponent is basically on a 2-turn clock. They're going to have to find something pretty amazing. All right, Bolt's pretty good there. That changes things slightly. Remember, our opponent still does have Worship in their deck, so the mark does work nicely with that. Let's get rid of... We can go land, pack rat, dreadboard next turn. So let's get rid of the Chandra, actually. Totally fine with that. We'll get in. So our opponent will fall down to 8. And this could be it for them. Let's see what they end up drawing here. Okay, Magus of the Moon not going to do anything right here besides gain a life and grow the champion to a 3-3. But I think that this should do it here. We'll take a draw. Okay, another Chandra. So, yeah, let's get in with all the rats. So our opponent will be forced to chump here. If we discard, our opponent will gain a life. And so it does not really matter too much here. So I think that we will be victorious this round. Norn the Wari is not going to really cut it for our opponent. And yeah, pretty interesting way to end the video. So we do win. And I just want to, you know, talk to you guys for about 30 seconds about this deck in general. So this deck, again, was made from the idea that I had that in Modern, there's lots of linear type strategies that they're doing one plan and they're just trying to do that one plan as quick as possible. Of course, there's some decks out there that are more controlling and have different variety, but I wanted to try to attack all those decks that just had this one plan. That's why I'm playing with the main deck Relics. That's why I'm playing with the 12 main deck discard spells. That's why, you know, we're playing with Blood Moon. So all those cards are really good against a lot of those decks. I think this video was awesome, and you know, I do really appreciate you guys watching. The deck is pretty difficult to play. I actually found myself making, you know, probably about a handful of misplays, and that's something that's going to happen when you are playing a new deck. I think in my Teemer Moon video, my play was much stronger because I've played the deck a lot and I'm more comfortable with playing those type of mid-range aggro tempo blue decks. This deck, definitely different style. So if you are interested in playing the Black-Red Bridgewalker deck, make sure you practice with it a lot. And the other thing is that I think we played against some decks in this video that were a bit more unique, especially this deck right here. But we are 2-0 in this league. So if we count the first league, 4-1, this league, 2-0. So 6-1 with this deck. And you know, my play hasn't been a 10 out of 10, and that's something that you guys can work with when you are picking up a new deck for Modern. Just get as many reps in as possible before you go to that important tournament, so you'll have the best chance to win. Regardless, this is Gerard Fabiano, and I do appreciate you guys watching the video. If you guys have any comments, I want to hear them, and I'll respond to as many as I can. So again, this is the Black-Red Bridgewalker deck. Take it easy, guys.